facilitate. And so I put forth to all of you and anyone, any of those who aren't here who you may know, that if you have any questions or thoughts or ideas around makerspaces in libraries, STEM programming in libraries, coding in libraries, to please get in touch with me. I definitely want to offer whatever sort of help I can, and I definitely want to hear about what all of you are doing in your libraries, and so I would love to make that connection. And to that aim, I just want to point you out to the website. It's my name, caseykunz.com, and it has a way to get in touch with me. It also has both of the presentations that I gave today. I'm actually just launching them from this site. So this is a particular important thing to note for the Code to Learn presentation. This is a link storm presentation. There's going to be link after link after link after link. So I don't expect you to write this stuff down. You can go back to this. All the links are live. Every image you'll see for a website, you click it, it'll take you right to the website. And another thing about this presentation, as you'll see, I believe that that there's a way that you can connect pretty much everyone to code, because as I'm going to try to show, code is a remarkably expressive thing to learn to do. It's not just a good job skill, but it's a way that you can express yourself in a myriad of different ways. And to that aim, I'm trying to show a variety of things that might appeal to you or might appeal to your patrons or to people you know. So if something really catches your eye and you're like, oh wow, that's really interesting and so forth, please use the computers in front of you. Go to the site, play around, ignore me for the rest of the presentation, that's fine. You can always go back and watch the video if you want to hear me ramble. You've always got access to the slides. If something interests you, by all means, look into it. Without further ado, we will go. Title of this presentation is Code to Learn, and it's kind of a it's a riff on something I've heard a lot of librarians say. I heard librarians that I grew up with when I was a kid hanging out in the public library say is that you don't learn to read, you read. And I am here to say that as librarians as you know, folks who work in public-facing education institutions, we should be sending the message, we should be adopting the message that you don't learn to code, you code to learn. That code is a language, it's a set of tools, it's a way you can interact with, understand, and participate in the world in so many different ways. It's not just for professionals, it's not just for geeks and nerds. and I have somebody who's going to make that argument for me, but first, we need to get our terms straight. And what I mean when I say code, what I mean when I say program, and for that, I want to share a little video from, this is from code.org.
But the smiley is face down, and only one person knows how to get there. Let's get this program started. A program is an algorithm that has been coded into something that can be run by a machine. Most of us think of a program as something that we write for a computer. Programs are really good for that, but they're also helpful in other places. You can make your own game or even program a robot to do things for you.
All right, so so a program is an algorithm that a machine can run. That's the definition that Heidi gave us from the code.org video. And that was actually an introduction to this activity that we're seeing modeled here in this animated GIF. And that gives us another word that we have to unpack. What is an algorithm? And an algorithm is a self-contained step-by-step set of instructions to be performed. I'm currently involved in a couple of different projects to teach computer coding to very young kids that just completed kindergarten. And when it first hit, when this was first presented to me, I was personally actually a bit flabbergasted. I was like, I don't know how to teach code to people who can't read and don't know how to add and subtract. That seems like maybe we should be teaching like math first. And you know, like I had this reaction, but then But then I started to look at the resources and I started to think about it, and the fact of the matter is that thinking like a computer programmer is it's not about computers necessarily. It's a way of thinking where you break down a process to its simplest operations. And a really great thing you can do when you're working with, say, kindergartners or first graders or second graders and you want to teach them code is the I'm a robot game. So I am a robot and you must give me commands and I need to pick up that mouse, right? Kids will say, pick up the mouse. And I'll say, does not compute, right? Like, because it's too complicated. I don't know, what do you mean? Like, so go over to the mouse, does not compute. So you get them to break it down to the simplest set, turn. Stop turning, move forward, lower your hand, close your hand, lift your hand. The simplest set of instructions to be performed. That's all an algorithm is, and that's all a program is, a computer program is. Computers are essentially machines that can perform mathematical and logical operations, but they only do what we tell them to do. They just do the series of steps that we have programmed into them. So code, or coding, is the translation of a human-readable algorithm into a program that a machine can perform. Now, you'll hear other people talk about computer programming and so forth. I, as a librarian, tend to talk about code and coding instead, because I'm a librarian. Programs and programming means something else in my world, and that gets confusing. So, like, I, you know, talking about doing a programming program, so instead, I try to say I'm doing a coding program, and I also like that because what coding is the action, right? Like the program is the noun, right? Like the program's the thing that you make the computer program, but the way that you make the computer program isn't really by programming, it's by coding. It's an act of translation, encoding, taking an idea that you have and you can express in your language, ordinarily. I want to roll two dice, I want to add the values together, and I want to know what it is, right? Like I'm making a game where dice are involved and so forth. So I can code that in a computer programming language. This is Python code. That Python is a programming language. This is Python code that does this set of algorithms. An important thing to understand about code, all code, is that it's made for humans, right? This language was designed so that we could read, understand, and write it, right? Like, because what the way that a computer operates, a computer on its most simplest terms, is basically just a series of billions of switches. Using electricity, there's only two things you can be. You can be on or off, and so, the way that all instructions are processed by a computer is in binary code, which is just sequences of flashes, on, off, on, off, on, off, on, off, on, off. And those translate to numbers, and those numbers translate to the instructions and the operations that we have programmed. So as obtuse and sometimes frustrating as coding and programming languages can seem sometimes, it's, you know, I find it sort of important to realize that, like, this is been designed to try to help us to write that, and I'm grateful for that because I wouldn't be up here if you still had to write the machine. But I had made some pretty outlandish statements about like coding is a way of expressing yourself and coding is an important thing. And rather than justify that and explain that myself, I'm going to share with you the argument of the guy I got the argument from. This is Sam Aran, who made one of the tools that we're going to be looking at today. And this is a TED talk that he did at Newcastle.
I'd like to tell you and talk to you about something that really is important to me. And I hope it's also important to you as well. And if it's not, I hope by the end of this talk you have something to think about that maybe when you wake up tomorrow after a sort of nice sleep, you think, actually, yes, I believe in what Sam's saying too. I'll start off by saying something probably quite stupid, that you think, why is someone asking that question? But it's a question that had been asked before, but the answers are very different. So hands up if you can read or write. Some people are opening their hands a bit. That's a bit strange. Okay, so I asked this question at schools all the time. So I do this kind of talk in schools a lot, and they all put their hands up, obviously. And then I say, hands up if, so you're adults, right? So hands up if you are already, or you're considering a career, professional career, as a writer. Some of you, right? Some of you, but not many. So the rest of you who learn to read or write, why have you bothered? What was that about, right? So I asked this, I was in Duxford talking to 200 primary school kids on Tuesday, and I asked this question, why do you bother to read or write if you're not going to become a professional writer? And the answers were beautiful. One girl said, because I can express myself. Right? It's a beautiful thing. Another girl said, because it's important to be able to read so I can actually read contracts. Right? So if I have a job, I know what am I getting into, right? We all click the I agree every time doing something online, so we're not necessarily using that skill. Right? And another person said, this is fantastic, because when I'm doing something, I want to be able to remember it for later, so I'll write it down, right? And then I can go back to it later and read it again. Well, this is academic papers, you know? This is us writing a to-do list, right? These are all important skills. Another girl said, so I can keep a diary, okay? And another girl said, this whole long-winded thing, so it was quite interesting to hear. But the essence was that she can read and write, so if someone else can't, then it's her duty really to help them because they're disadvantaged. Okay? So not so long ago, we would say, if I asked the question, most people wouldn't put their hand up because most people couldn't read or write. I said, why would you bother? Well, I work on the farm. I don't need to learn to read or write. That's not an important thing for me. But clearly today, it's not an acceptable position, really, to say, I don't get reading or writing, it's not for me, right? Because it's so fundamentally useful. Now, I'm going to make the argument, it's the same for programming, and it's the same for coding. Now, you'll hear all the time, especially today, coding's important, you need to learn to code because you can get a job as a professional programmer, right? That's not why you should learn to code. In the same way, you don't learn to read or write to become a professional reader or a professional writer. Some of you might do, some of you might become professional programmers, some kids I speak to may become professional programmers, but that's not why everyone should do it. And so I just wanted to get that laid down as a fundamental thing to talk about. And so when we start talking about why we should learn to code, we need to think about how we can do it, you know, and why. So the why isn't the same as reading and writing. You can be amazingly expressive with code. You can remember things with code, specifically process, how to do stuff. Code is amazing at describing and capturing process. Okay, so there's lots of things. What were the other examples? So we'll be able to remember things, we'll be able to store things, we'll be able to express ourselves. And then the other thing is, the funny thing, is that people who can't code are disadvantaged. Think about that. And most of you guys now are in that category. So you can probably do something about it. And why would you do something about it? Because it's so amazing, and you can express yourselves in ways you could never imagine. Right? And that's the disadvantage. It's not a disadvantage as in your lives aren't great right now. I'm sure they're all fantastic lives, but they could be better, right, if you learn to code. And so I built, and I'm not a joke, right? I'm really, really, really serious about this. So I built a tool that...
So Sam Aron built a... racing through it. Built a tool called Sonic Pi, which we're going to look at towards the end of the presentation today, which is one of these amazing tools you can use to express yourself with code. But I absolutely agree with his belief and his hope and his assertion that that learning a little bit of code is worthwhile for practically everybody today. And the reason for that is the world we live in the United States, a very privileged sort of world to live in, certainly not everybody lives there, but the world in which we live, more and more of these digital devices, more and more software is entering our lives. And to know a little bit of code, to understand a little bit of how these things work, how they interoperate, what they're doing with our data, right? Like, that's a literacy that has immense importance to us, right? And to put it another way, actually, when he's, you know, when he says that, like, you're disadvantaged if you don't know how to do code, there are other people, there are other programmers who have pointed out there's a pretty big irony right now with the state of computers, computer technology, the internet, and coding, and that is that all of this incredible stuff, the World Wide Web, the internet, all this incredible stuff you can do for free, like all the videos, the email, and the social media, and all this stuff, it presents the web as this radically democratic place, right? Like that's what we've been thinking about it for years, right? Like is that like on the internet you can start a business, right? Like just on your laptop you can start a business, and bam, you could end up Craigslist, or bam, you could end up eBay and become Elon Musk and the world's first real supervillain. Like, and you can just, like, there's no barriers to entry. But there's an irony if we talk about the web and about computers as radically democratic, when less than 9% of the population knows how to write web pages. Right? It's really a tiny percentage of our population that is behind the architecture behind this wildly democratic place. That's not really democratic, right? Like, and so as librarians, as we want to foster not only STEM skills, but to foster foster democracy and just foster literacy as a matter of something that it helps people to live in the world, that STEM literacy and coding literacy is very important. So, So if you own a code, or if you have a patron, perhaps a teenager, maybe an adult, who says, I want to learn to code, there are so many resources. I'm going to go through quite a few of them. There's even more than I can go through online and other ways that you can learn this. And so how do you facilitate their search for knowledge? Where do you send them? Well, you need to do a bit of a reference interview with a person like this, and with yourself, if you're thinking about learning to code. And what I will do often when somebody says, I really want to learn to code, is the next thing that I ask them is, well, what is it that you want to make, right? And this goes back to the thing I discussed in my earlier presentation today about project-based programming and project-based approaches to learning, is to say, coding is a skill that helps you to produce something. So what is it that you hope to produce? Because there are different languages and there are different tools that you would use to produce different things. So a lot of things today are made for the World Wide Web, for the web, web design, and that includes a lot of applications, right? Like, so that includes things like, you know, Facebook and Google Drive, Google Docs, right? Like these, it's a full word processor. This is a Google Slide, so this is a full like presentation software, and it's all in a web page. So that's a web application, that's a program. And if you want to design something like that, then the things you want to learn are HTML, JavaScript, and CSS. That's where you want to start. Right? Sometimes people will tell me that they want to create smartphone apps, right? Like they want to create apps for smartphones and iOS devices, like iPhones, iPads, those kinds of things. And there are a couple of things, right? Like I will ask them. Sometimes I will try to get them back over to this, because there's an argument to be made that if you can make a web app that works on a computer and works on a tablet, you have a larger audience for your product. So that might be a better place for your product. But if their product is something like, no, it really needs to be something written for an Android phone, then there are the MIT App Inventor is a very interesting piece of software. It doesn't involve a lot of hard coding, a lot of typing. It's similar to an approach we're going to look at, like Scratch, where you drag and drop sort of like pieces and construct your program that way. So very, very quick to make. It's very easy to make Android apps with the App Inventor very quickly without having to know very much code. So that's a good place to start for that, and it's a nice kind of place to noodle around. If people are really serious about developing for Android, or if they're looking at developing for other kinds of embedded devices, certain kinds of robots, Java is a programming language. And then if they're interested in developing for Apple products, there's a new language that Apple put out called Swift. And just a reminder, everything here is a live link. So if you click this, you'll go to Swift. If you click this, you'll go to Java. so forth and so on. If after all that, the person tells me, I don't know what I want to make. I just need to learn some code. I just want to learn how to program, right? Like, because I, for whatever reason, right? Like, I just want to learn, right? That's when I will suggest that they learn Python. The reason that I suggest Python is because it's a very clean language. It seems like strange, but it's just to say this as being very important. But it's pleasing to the eye. It's also a fairly modern language, and so a lot of the stuff that older, more traditional programming languages you have to worry about, you don't have to worry about in Python because it does a lot of stuff in the background for you, right? So it's an excellent language to learn the principles of coding, because once you learn the principles, right, like the differences in the language really are just syntax, right? They're just like, you know, loops are the same in most languages, and yeah.
Oh, I just, because I really, you know, bottom line here, I know nothing. So, but if, say, you created a Python one that's the more modern,
yep,
easy thing, and you wanted to just insert it into something that you own or have,
mm-hmm,
that, I mean, would it screw things up, or?
No, it wouldn't, actually, and that's the other thing about the question of programming language, which is that if it's a popular programming language, there's probably a way to do almost anything you want using that language. So an example, like I said, if you wanted to make a web app, you should learn HTML5, JavaScript, and CSS3. But you can. There are technologies that will let you make a web app using Python, right? Like, there are technologies that will let you make an Android app using Python. It might not be the best or the easiest way to do the thing that you want, right? Like, but it's definitely possible. So, one of the reasons I like Python is because one thing that like I developed and I think other people developed, and just to be clear, like, computer programming is not really part of my day job at all. So. And so, insofar as I use it, it's very much on a sort of a case-by-case, and there's deliberate practice, but then there's also kind of just like noodling around and exploring and stuff. One of the reasons I like Python is because it's so clean and it's so quick that it's very easy, once you know a few tricks in Python, to make really simple little scripts that can solve problems. So, I remember that, like, when I was the director of Telefree Library, we had an issue where we had a database, lynda.com, that was available to all the patrons in the whole library system. And I wanted to know how many people in my library were using it, right? Like, I wanted to know, because I was doing a very aggressive marketing campaign for Lynda. I was trying to get lots of people in Tully to use it. And I wanted to know how successful that was. But Lynda didn't know, right? Like, Lynda's client was the library system, so they didn't have any idea who my patrons were. And so their data basically just had a list of patrons, and so what I did was I created a little Python script that could take a list of library card numbers that Lynda had provided, and a list of library card numbers that I had pulled off of my integrated library system that I knew were Tully library numbers, and the script, which was six lines of code, compared the two lists, and then spat out 11 Tully patrons used Lynda this month. 13 Tully patrons used Lynda this month. It gave me that data. And that was, you know, so it becomes this little tool in your tool belt, right? Like, where, like Sam said, like, recording process. If there's something that you, if there's an operation that you do over and over and over and over and over and over again in Excel, or, you know, just using your computer generally, odds are pretty strong that there's a way you can use just a tiny little bit of code to automate that. Just never have to do it again, really. Just be able to just push a button and have it just happen, right? So, so there are some local resources. Not all of you are close to Syracuse, New York, but there is this. There are these learning lunches. I don't know, Matthew, if you want to talk about other opportunities.
Sure, we're doing it's 2 hours every Thursday it's just a space to code. And if you can't be there and you still want to participate, let me know, because you can participate from wherever you are. The whole idea of it is to have a punctuation, a set time where you're going to do that. You're going to work through exercises on Free Code Camp. You're going to work through one of the other code games that Casey is going to show us and learn about that. And that's, you know, that's it. It's often easier, especially when you're starting, to have that set period in your schedule. It's on your calendar. Whether you're going to be sitting at your desk or coming to our office or anywhere else, just putting it on your calendar so that that's the time reserved for learning is incredibly useful, because it does take some attention. It does take some focus.
Yeah,
so that's the purpose of those sessions. And there you go.
Yeah, and it takes a certain amount of deliberate practice, you know. So it doesn't have to be hard, but I know over the course of my life, as I've been in various forms of graduate school and I've been just sort of interested in coding, I probably learned how to do the same things in Python at least 4 times, right? Like, because I get interested, I go through something, and then I don't use it, and months and months go by, and I forget it, and then I'm back, and then my interest is rekindled, but I have to start over again. And so something you can do to really sort of enshrine it and say, like, you know, this is the time each week that I do another thing, I build something with code. Because it's through that practice that you'll really start to build a set of skills. Resource, a really incredible resource that's available for free to, oops. I was having a clipping good slide too, so let's try. All right. So lynda.com, for those of you that don't know, is a site that's full of video courses on all different matters of technology. It's a fantastic place if you want to learn. I'll just bring up their library here. It's a fantastic place if you're interested in learning design software. That was actually where they got their start. It's Linda herself was sending DVDs of Photoshop tutorials in the mail. That was her business, I remember, because my father would get them. But there are also now tons of different courses around different aspects of code. So here under developer, you can see everything from programming foundations and then specific programming languages. You know, like I think Lynda is the go-to for me if I have a patron who has a certain familiarity with code, right? Like, but they're like, I really need to, like, I have this thing that I made for this Android phone and I want to make the iOS version, and I'm in kind of a hurry. I say, okay, well, lynda.com has some really great tutorials for people just like you, which is a course for somebody who knows programming but needs to get up to speed really quickly on how to do things in a different language, right? Like, and I don't know if I'm not logged in, if it will actually let me take a look at a preview. The course, each course will have a series of chapters, a series of videos, and an interactive transcript, so you can move around. If the lecturer says something, you can click a sentence and you can go back. And another thing that they have that I find is really great about Lynda classes is that if you're working with a particular piece of software during a Lynda class, like there's some really great Microsoft Office courses on Lynda. So like if you're doing like an Excel course, they make all the files that they're using available to download, so you can download the file and work alongside them. And when they make the change and do the thing, you can have on your computer and make the change and do the thing. I don't know how many of you may qualify for a card in the Onondaga County Library System. Those of you who do have access to Lynda through your library card. So if you go to onlib.org and go to databases and find Lynda, you can log into Lynda and have full access to it with your library card. And CLRC also makes Lynda available.
Yep. I'm not sure if Mid York has a Lynda setup, do you know?
Mid York
does not.
We were using the
through CLRC. Yeah. So all of you are eligible for, all you have to do is go to clrc.org and under, I think, resources, there's lynda.com, and you just apply for a license and we will issue it to you. They're usually good for about a month at a time. You can get them again, and often we won't take it away right away because there's not always a huge demand and we've got a lot of licenses. So that's good for any staff member at any library that CLRC serves. And there you go. All
right, so moving deeper into the Linkstorm, one of the big names in online code education is Code Academy. And Code Academy is it's a good site. And it's similar to a lot of tutorial of sites you'll find today, which is that learn to code interactively, right? Like, so Code Academy offers a series of courses in a variety of languages. They have a really great course in Python. They also have they've got websites, how to make an interactive website, how to use all of these different things are topics that you can learn. And by interactive, basically what it means is that you'll have some code, you'll be given some code, or you'll be instructed to write some code in an editor, right in your browser, and then have the ability to run that code and see how it actually performs. And you have a series of assignments as you're moving through and learning new things. They'll give you an assignment to say, now make your code do this, like now make your code do this. And it's really nice. It's a really nice way to sort of like build and learn. It's a very good tutorial. The reason I sort of hedge is because it's that like come for free aspect of it, which Code Academy used to be completely for free. A couple of months ago, they switched their payment model, and so now you can do all the tutorials for free, but all of the quizzes and exams are locked behind a paywall. So that aspect of the interactivity is not available for free. And so I would think, like, if you've got somebody who's got a lot of interest needs a platform to really learn these skills, Code Academy is a really great place. But in terms of offering the complete structure that is so important to learning to code, it's a little fractured in that sense. Khan Academy, some of you may know, is a great place to learn, again, all kinds of things. And they are a nonprofit foundation, and when they say for free for everyone forever, they mean it. And they have a really interesting curriculum. So here you can see they're really great for math, all the different kinds of math. But they have an interesting computer programming course. It uses a special language called processing. So you see introduction to JS drawing and animation, right? It's interesting because this launches you into manipulating visual things, creating animations, creating circles and graphics on the computer using code right away, and that's a really interesting. And if you have someone who's frankly kind of like me, I'm a very visual person. If you have someone who's interested in learning how to code but is very interested in like in visualizations and really benefits from that ability to see what, you know, to see what you're doing, then this and processing, which I'll talk about a little bit more deeply and demonstrate later in the program, is a really good program. It's a really good place to go. Free Code Camp is another one that's got a really great. This one I would recommend for folks who are interested in that web development. They have just a fantastic program that takes you really like all the way through everything that you need to know to make a web app, right? Like, and they even go so far as, I think one of the things that impresses me about Free Code Camps tutorials is they make as part of your education engaging with the coding community. And that's something that's really important if you're working on code and you're interested in coding, your patrons are interested in coding and working on coding, is that the coding community is vast and, generally speaking, very eager to help, right? There are all kinds of places, including GitHub and Stack Exchange, where you can go to see if people have asked questions about a certain problem that you're having. I'd say that like 90% of the time I have a bug, somebody else has had that exact same bug, and the answer is on Stack Exchange. If I just search for the bug in Google, I get a result from Stack Exchange where somebody had the exact same problem, and somebody just offered up in their free time, I had that problem too, here's what you got wrong, right? And FreeCodeCamp does this. FreeCodeCamp also offers some pretty nice certifications when you complete one of their courses, which can be a good thing to give to employers. It's not, I mean, it's about as official as every kind of certification these days, but, you know, it is a nice sort of documentation that you've gone through this pretty rigorous way. The final in this series that I wanted to recommend is a bit of a black sheep. It's called Learn.
It's linked.
What?
It's in your presentation.
Yeah, the link didn't work. So unlike everything else that I've suggested so far, this is actually a resource that isn't free. This is a book that is available for $29.95. But it is also quite generously available for free. So what you get when you pay for it is a whole bunch of videos to accompany the book, as well as the book and a DVD and stuff. But it is free to read online, so you can get started with it. You can actually go through the entire book, but you can definitely preview it, and I recommend that you do preview it if you want to take this approach. What Zed Shaw means by the hard way is Zed's approach very much focuses on that discipline and that grit and that experimentation and that practice that is so essential to programming. And so he has an interesting kind of rhythm to the exercises. So what he'll do is he says, type, not copy and paste, but type this code exactly into your text editor, right? And he tells you to type it because you're trying to build a certain amount of muscle memory in your use, right? Like you're trying to get your fingers used to typing this stuff. And, you know, to some extent, there are some unusual punctuation in code. You'll use curly brackets way more often than you usually do. And so, like, getting to a point where you can write that quickly without making typos is an important skill to learn. But the other thing that he does is he gives you the code, says, write it, run it, observe what it does, then do these study drills, and then in the next chapter, he'll explain what you should have learned. So unlike a lot of these tutorials where like Code Academy or Free Code Camp, they'll say, this is this thing, this is this bit of code, this is an image tag, this is how you can display an image on a website, right? Like, use it this way, this is how you type it. Now use an image tag on your website. That would be like your traditional approach. The hard way approach is copy this bit of code you don't know, you don't understand it, you've never seen before. Run it and see what it does. Figure it out for yourself. Break it. Make some changes. See how you can, see how you can manipulate it and how you can extend it, right? And then I'll tell you what you should have seen. Then I will help you. And so I find this useful as, as I've said, struggling kind of like with the, with that that discipline, that grit, that this approach offers a really sort of almost like a it's almost like martial arts. It's like this is what you this is the practice, right? And so I personally found it a valuable resource, and I've also connected a number of teenagers who really were passionate about coding, but had that same issue with that discipline, that practice, that grit with this approach, and they found it to be a good way of doing it. They've been able to stick with this and get more out of it than they were able to do out of things like Code Academy. Like, they'll say they did Code Academy, and I'll say, okay, so that means you should be able to do this, and they have no idea because they don't remember anything from Code Academy. But this is harder, but you actually do remember more. Okay, so that was a bunch of links. We're gonna take a coding break. gonna stop talking about code, and we're gonna do some coding. So, if you could open a browser and go to blockly-games.appspot.com. Should see something like this, and we want to look at the main. So this, if it's not obvious already, was made by Google. And if you go to the mains, so this is an approach to teaching coding to beginners, to kids and adults, that has become kind of the standard. It was really pioneered by MIT and a program of theirs called Scratch. But what it does is it takes the code that you would write, and it breaks it down into these modular pieces. So in that same way where, like, we just think about a code program that's just a set of instructions, it's just an algorithm, we break those into these pieces that we can just drag and drop and connect to one another. And so we need to go forward twice, is it? Yeah. And then a nice thing about this tutorial is that it actually tells us what JavaScript we would have typed to get that same result. So it's not really that much different from what we did, right? Like, there are some parentheses and there's a semicolon at the end, but that's really only the only difference. So we're going to take a little break, and I want to encourage you to do a couple of these games, and then, you know, we'll look at level 6.
Really?
Yeah.
See, I would have no idea.
So go ahead and reset.
Okay, reset.
And it looks like, I mean, just think about what you want that guy to do. Just move forward once or twice.
Okay, so just do it and then run it and then do it again. Just move it forward.
You could grab the one, they go as a group from, like, if you grab onto it. Yeah. Should be good.
Oh, that's all I have to do?
Well, your goal is to get that guy to go over there.
Oh, that's it?
That's it, yeah.
Wow.
Oh, that's all you want to do? I was trying to make him go other places.
That's what I was trying to do.
Yeah, that's for later levels.
Okay.
This is really perfect for me.
Oh my gosh, that's so cool.
Can we move to level two then after we've done that?
Yeah.
Ah, gotcha. Okay.
Moving on. Okay.
You're doing terrible.
I am.
Did you do a logo back in the day?
I was an engineer back in the day.
So you did much more than logo. Well, you're on the line already.
Oh, I have no idea what that is. Where should I be? I'm a real native.
Oh, that's all right. Why don't we back you up to
one.
Back you up to one. So,
okay.
So here you see, like, we're just...
I'm in a maze.
You're in a maze, and you want to go, and you can move and you can turn. So the arrow shows the direction that the person's pointing.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And then that's how you kind of negotiate. And we can, and if we run the program, we can test, we can watch those move forward.
Okay,
so those are
okay.
Two spaces.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And then here we learn, like, you got to do a series of turns.
Yeah.
Right? And then this is where things get a little...
Oh, no. I got it. But only out of elimination.
But that's how it works. That's the thing. You end up...
So that's what that says, you repeat.
Pressing run on a program.
Oh, okay.
So if we just say,
loading on
repeat
page.
Until that,
and right.
It's all broken.
No. Uh-huh.
And then what do?
Okay.
You keep working on it. Keep, you know, that's how you learn how to do it, by learning how.
Yep, that's what you would have typed.
Uh-huh.
Wow. It would be nice if it would show us what the more efficient code would be. Because I feel like I can write it, but there might be a better way of writing
thank
it.
You.
And it just says, okay, you got to the
next
spot.
That's the next game.
Oh, so.
Better code, not just move forward.
So just drag another move forward. This is like your palette. So drag that over to your canvas and connect it. Yep. Now that should probably be enough. So if you run the program. Everyone's gotten a real little tiny taste.
Mm-hmm.
I thought I would just illustrate
illustrate my answer to number six. So,
I'm not even there.
So, this, I don't know if it's better. I mean, and to that question, like, actually, I think that's pretty bad, actually. I think, actually, I could have a lot better. Yeah.
I can do that one leg less than you.
Just do this, right?
Wow.
Like that.
Exactly.
Yeah. But, so this, the reason why Scratch and its cousins like Blockly are really great is because it illustrates, it very quickly illustrates the different sort of, the types of puzzle pieces, the types of functions we can use in code and the kinds of things that code can do. So I like the way that they represent loops, right, like as this sort of thing that kind of encapsulates the code in the loop. Because like Sam Aran says, code is excellent at capturing process. And one of the things that happens in processes that we do is we often have to repeat a process over and over and over again. Sometimes we need to repeat a process until something is finished, until a certain result is achieved, right? You know, I need to fill the tea kettle with water continually until it is full of water, right? So one of the efficiencies that code gives us is loops, is you can code, repeat this X number of times. You can code, repeat this until something happens. And then you only have to say the instruction once. And that not only is more efficient, but it's better in terms of sharing your code with others, and also if you ever need to make changes to your code. Right? Where you can, in code, where you can just describe an instruction in one place means that if you ever have to make a change, you can just change it in that one place and know with confidence that it's your code is completely changed. Whereas if you have code where you just have a series of instructions over and over that you could encapsulate in these loops, right? You have to make sure that you change every single line if you need to make a change. Moving on to some resources of a different type. These are resources that are well-suited to kids and teens. The first of these is, the first thing I need to mention, I always forget about this, which is Facebook has a site called TechGraph. It seems like a lot of things, a lot of Google and a lot of other companies are promoting CS, computer science, and coding and stuff. And it seems like this is Facebook's offering. It's a little misleading because they are not actually offering any tutorials themselves here. But what they do, what they are offering is, I think, something almost better. And that is, it's a resource guide. So you can go to TechPrep and you can answer a series of questions. So we'll pretend to be a 12-year-old kid, right? And say, I'm a beginner. I definitely like games. I also like toys. View my resources. And what it gives is a list of different tutorials suited to my age, suited to my interest. And they're constantly updating this as new things hit the web. That are exciting and so forth, they get added to this. And so this is one of the big takeaways I say. If you have a kid who asks you, I want to learn to code, where should I start? One thing you could do, which might be the best answer to give them, is let's go to techprep.facebook.fb.com. Right? Like, and you can either go through it with them or have them do it themselves, and then they have a curated list of resources. So a lot of the stuff that I'm going to talk about, Scratch and Khan Academy, I've already talked about, right? Like, they point you to those, and that is a really great resource. Scratch was made by MIT, this is very, very similar to that Blockly program that we just done. We just did a little bit of noodling around in. It's a little bit more featureful. So you can see, this is what Scratch looks like. It looks a lot like what we were just doing. right? Like we've got the repeat loop here. We've got things like move 10 steps, change the color to play drum, right? And what Scratch allows people to do is to basically take these sprites, so like the cat and the Powerpuff Girls there, and program their actions using this drag and drop. You can do a lot with Scratch. It's an excellent place to start. And like I said, its similarity to written code is so strong. I think it's an excellent place for kids to start, because when they move into start handwriting code, it's going to look a lot the same. Like the brackets, the indentation are going to look the same. So code.org is another fantastic place for connecting with programs for kids. They do every year in December something called the Hour of Code. Links to it right here, where they have these programs that take an hour. Again, a lot like that Blockly thing that we all just did a few minutes ago. That same Scratch drag and drop sort of thing. They have them in all kinds of, they have them themed in all kinds of different ways. So, you know, trying to connect to kids' interests and so forth. So they've got Minecraft and Star Wars and Frozen, right? These different themes. They're also really great because they've gotten a lot of, you know, like behind these are all kinds of videos with pretty interesting famous people. So the original Hour of Code has all of these icons of the tech industry, Mark Zuckerberg and other people interested, like Will.i.am, the pop star from the Black Eyed Peas, gives an introduction and talks about it. In the Code with Anna and Elsa, there are a number of fashion models who give the introduction and explain how they started in modeling, but have started to learn computer programming to move into a second career, and in addition to this, so the first thing I would say, if you're thinking about I want to do a coding program with kids, just doing an hour of code, saying there's going to be an hour of code, and connecting the kids with one of these things, you know, to say that deciding we're going to Star Wars and all do the same thing, or just give them free rein and say do whichever one you want, is a fantastic way, and it's really great pre-baked curriculum. If you're looking for more, they have entire courses for different ages. So you see course one is for early readers ages 4 to 6. And if we look at this, each of these courses is a 20-hour course. So they have unplugged activities where you get up and you move around, or you use paper and cardboard, as well as a series of interactive online activities that not only teach that Scratch programming, but also teach basic computer skills, like how to use the mouse, right? Like, and all of the things. And so this is a fantastic place. And in terms of the program that I'm developing in partnership with the Syracuse City Schools to teach a kind of coding summer camp for young kids, 95% of our curriculum is right there, you're looking at it. Mozilla Thimble is an interesting place. This is much more web development, so learning HTML and CSS. So in the same way that a lot of these things work, you have this interactive sort of thing. So I have the code over here. And then I have the representation. I have the representation over here, so I can change this. I say, welcome to Code to Learn. And then in the CSS here, I could say H1. So the other thing that Thimble allows is it has all of these things that are kind of like posters, right? Where kids, and you know, grown-ups too, but it's really sort of marketed to kids. Kids can take a poster, and they can hit this button at the top of the page called Remix, where they'll get the code for the poster, and they can change it the way I just did. And then they can post the new poster as their own, right? And so, again, it's a really good way of learning how to code and learning how to do these things is to take somebody else's example, break it, change some things about it, run it, see how it goes. And Thimble offers that same experience and tools to do it with regards to HTML. Code combat, I discussed in a presentation earlier today. This is a good tool for kids that are really interested in games and like gaming on the internet and stuff like that, and maybe interested but not quite as interested in coding. It's a pretty standard adventure game in the sense of you choose a character and you have to get weapons and armor for your character, and you're going into the cursed forests and dungeons and castles, and you have to fight goblins and get buried treasure and all that sort of stuff. But the catch and what makes it code combat is that the way that you play the game is by writing code. So you don't control the character directly. You have to write a script using the programming language of your choice. Python's available, as is JavaScript and others. And then depending on your script, that will dictate how the character moves and what the character does. And sometimes, you know, one of the ways you saw it in Blockly, right, like one of the things that code combat incentivizes is to say you get bonus points if you don't write that much code, right? Like, so if you keep it nice and short, you use lots of loops when you can use loops, right? You get bonus points and your character gets stronger. So code combat is a good thing if you want to have like an after-school code club and you want to be kind of informal. I have had kids tell me that they don't like how slow code combat is. So kids that are really seriously interested in learning to code probably won't be satisfied by this, because the acquisition of actual coding knowledge is pretty slow. So if you're thinking about doing a coding program in your library, you're thinking of doing a kids' coding program in your library, you don't have to do it alone. There are a number of different organizations, nonprofit organizations around the world, who offer resources to those who are interested in putting together coding clubs for kids. Coder Dojo is based in Ireland and is a really great organization. And what these different groups can offer is, if you're in a position where maybe you connect with a member of your community who's really interested in spearheading a kind of coding club for kids, right? Like, and you want to partner with them and make the library the place where that happens. You want to offer them, you know, the space to do it and the computers to do it, right? They can use, and you can work with them to use, partner with an organization like Coder Dojo, or Girls Who Code is another great one if you're looking for creating a female oriented coding program, which is vitally important because we need more young women, we need more women in the STEM fields, we need more women in coding, and so that is a very sort of vital thing. And what these things can give you is resources for how to recruit volunteers, marketing materials, as well as a network of all these other people running similarly affiliated clubs all around the world, and you can share programming ideas and just basically join a whole network of people who can help you to create a nice structured, long-standing coding after-school program. All right, so the next section after this. That I'm going to move into now is really getting back to the crux of that, is how you can code to express yourself, different ways you can code to express yourself. But before I go there, are there any questions about any of the things that I've shared with you, or any tools that you absolutely love you want to throw and add to the mix? Yep.
Well, I have a page on our website, it's a Google document. It's just a list of places where adults, basically adults who have not, didn't grow up with technology, okay? So their struggle is not being, their struggle is being comfortable with the equipment, okay?
Yep.
It's not, which is something that I think younger people don't deal with. They don't, that's not an issue for them.
Yeah.
You know, they are willing to walk up and touch,
yeah,
you know, things, you know, technology, equipment,
mm-hmm,
you know, whatever it is. They're not intimidated by the actual physical machines.
Yeah.
Adults who didn't grow up with technology, maybe a typewriter was the most,
yeah,
technological,
yeah,
thing they ever touched in their lives, you know,
mm-hmm,
have a real, that's a real barrier.
Yeah, it sounds to me like you're pointing to the issue of digital literacy,
right,
which is a really crucial issue, and
right,
one that I think we are many libraries are engaging with,
right,
and I think many libraries are struggling to engage with.
Right.
CLRC has,
yes,
actually a special interest group.
Right.
I'm a member of it right now, and we're trying to put together some resources.
Right. And I'm a member of it too, except,
yeah,
I haven't made it to a meeting.
Yeah. So I think that, you know, that's absolutely something. And you raise a good point. I don't want to go down digital literacy like today, but you make an excellent point, which is that that is absolutely something that you should keep in mind in terms of if you're doing technology programming in the library, and you want to do coding programming in the library, you want to seriously consider how you can also do some kind of digital literacy programming in the library. Because, you know, like, you're not going to give somebody skills that they can create into a new career if they have before them that barrier to they don't know how to use the mouse.
Right.
They're not comfortable, really. They don't really understand the distinction between a program and a web page and, you know, and all those kinds of things. Actually, you know, so that's definitely something, you know, worth mentioning, and I'm glad you did.
Right.
Going towards coding to express yourself, and back to Sam Aran. Sam Aran created a software program called Sonic Pi, and the Pi there is in reference to the Raspberry Pi computer. So there's a picture of it right there. I don't know if it, no. The Raspberry Pi is an unusual thing. You can see it right there. It's a computer. It's everything that's in these boxes here, about the size of a credit card, and costs $40. Right. So you plug a monitor and keyboard and mouse into it. It goes online and it can do everything a computer can do. The Raspberry Pi was originally designed in Great Britain as a response to the commodification of technology. A group of engineers and software engineers who grew up in the 80s remembered their experience of computers as children. And because it was the 80s and they were very basic, things like the ZX Spectrum, ZX Spectrum, and for me it was a Tandy 1000 MS-DOS machine in my parents' business. You really had to confront the guts of the machine in order to use it back then, right? Like, I remember I had this personal experience where we had this Tandy 1000, right? Like, and we got a game for it, but the way the game came was there was a stack of paper that came in the mail, which was the code in Quick Basic for a kind of a Atari breakout game, So my dad sat me down when he took the paper and typed that code into the computer, right? And then that code would flash over the screen every time I would play the game. So I had this real, like, I understood there was this relationship between these weird symbols and the game, and I investigated it and discovered that if I found the right spot in that sequence of things, I could give myself infinite lives. I could give myself like 9,000 free plays. And so that was the first time I ever hacked anything when I was like six, right? Like, and And what the, you know, so what the engineers who devised the Raspberry Pi had sort of were sort of bemoaning is that we've moved away from that kind of, you don't have that experience with technology anymore. These smartphones are so sleek, right? Like it's not immediately apparent how you can even open them up, right? So you can't really tell what's going on inside. They don't really want you to know what's going on inside. And the operating systems, the touch operating systems, are also so user friendly. They abstract so much of what's going on behind the scenes. And that what's happened is that they've, computers and especially like these smart devices have essentially become objects of consumption, right? Like we don't, it's that there's an app for that, right? Like there's something that somebody else made, again, that democratic problem, right? Like there's something that somebody else made that's maybe free, maybe it's a couple bucks, I can download to my phone and it'll solve a problem I have. But they've lost that potential, that imagination that this is a platform on which I could solve my own problems. I could develop my own solutions to problems, my own apps. I could express myself on this. And so the Raspberry Pi was very much designed as a really cheap, basic computer that kids who maybe didn't have a whole lot of money, families that didn't have a whole lot of money, could afford this computer, and is basic enough, it could give kids that same sort of experience, right? Like learning how to code. And there's a lot of great stuff available for the Raspberry Pi around that topic. Sonic Pi is one of those products. This is Sonic Pi. I've loaded it here. And what Sonic Pi is, it's a programming environment and it's a musical instrument. So you can code music. We have a series of, we have a set of Raspberry Pis called Kanos that we make available to kids. And in it, they can do all kinds of things. They can use Scratch to make Pong and stuff. Inevitably, I'll have a group that's maybe a little bit older, a little bit more experienced, that will finish way ahead of everybody else. And so what I will do is I'll launch Sonic Pi, which is on them because they're Raspberry Pis, and I will just teach them two commands. There's this play followed by a number, and so what do you think is going to happen now?
Can I play two numbers?
No.
Two notes.
Two notes? Like, how's it going to play?
It's going to go up.
Let's see.
Oh, it does them together.
Plays them at the same time, right? Like, so that's why I teach them two commands. I teach them play and sleep. And that's all I give them. I'm like, you say play and you say sleep and go, right? Like, and then they're so into it that when I have hot piping pizza for them saying the program's over, you can have pizza now, and so forth, they say 20 more minutes, just 10 more minutes, just let me try some more. So there are many other examples, many other things, and if you see down here at the bottom, let's see if I can drag this up. Sonic Pi has a whole course on itself, built into itself. So down here at the bottom, you see, well, this says, welcome to Sonic Pi. It explains what it is in terms of live coding. It gives you all kinds of little bits of example code here. So we've got this little bit of code, four lines of code. Now, an interesting thing about this is that Sam Aran actually uses this as a musical instrument. He and others actually perform live concerts with this, and the way that they do that is by actually editing the code live while people are there dancing. And to demonstrate that, I'll do the same thing. So I can just edit it. So it gives you a whole course of study here of how to use, you know, it starts you out, your first beeps, right? And with beeps and sleeps, you've got everything you need really for Beeps and Sleeps to do any kind of composition that you might see in sort of traditional music. So. Sonic Pi is a programming language. Oh, I just attached. And so you can use all of those efficiencies and interesting things in a programming language to make your music. And so a lot of Sam Aran's music is interesting because he injects elements of random into it, because you can generate random numbers using computer programming. And so he creates certain bounds saying basically, of these six notes, randomly choose one. Right, like, and then so every time he plays the song, it's a little bit different, right? Like, because it involves this random element, and certainly looping. I think we can all see the value and the applicability of looping to music, right? Like, you know, you play this on the drums over and over and over again until the song ends. You play this for four bars and so forth and so on. In addition to 11 chapters and several appendices of this course, you can go through. That basically teaches you all the different aspects of Sonic Pi and how to use it. Here's the chapter on randomization. If you switch down here to examples, there are all of these examples of code provided, again, so that you can see somebody else's examples, so that you can watch it, run it, make some changes, see what happens. And also, it's a good way to demonstrate what it's actually capable of. So if I switch over here, I'm going to zoom out a little bit. I just wanted to give an example of that efficiency. So it got a little slow here, but I've got it all on the screen. So we just got 40 lines of code. And some of these lines just have the word end, and some of the lines are just empty. So 40 lines of code sounds like this.
So I know somebody who, you know, he does new music, right? And he's a music professor and all that. Is this what he's doing? I mean, I have no idea.
I have no idea what he's doing.
So, you know, like, when you go to a concert and it's new music, I mean, could this be part of it too?
It might. I'm not familiar with that term, new music. I don't know what genre that describes.
Like new age?
No, not new age. No,
just
I forget
music.
What they call it. Anyway, I'll think about that.
Yeah.
I'll just ask them.
You should. Yeah.
Okay.
I wanted to share with you Sonic Pi because if you or anyone you know, any patrons or certainly any kids you know or teens you know go in your library who are really passionate about music and interested in code, they should know about Sonic Pi because it's a wonderful way to express yourself musically in very innovative and unique kinds of ways, at the same time developing a real practical skill in coding, because once you do this, like, again, it's those same fundamental operations of break it down into steps, and you can loop, and you can make these sort of decisions where you say if this, then that, and those are the building blocks of all this different kinds of code. Next, for the visual, we have processing. And this is processing isn't actually a proper programming language, it's what's called a module or a library in computer programming. And what that means is it's kind of language agnostic. You can do processing in Java, you can do it in JavaScript, or you can do it in Python. You get to choose. But what it offers, all those different languages, is a very direct, simple to use set of tools for doing illustrations and visualizations. And what do you get by coding a drawing rather than drawing it yourself? Well, you get the opportunity to add interactivity to your art, right? And this, what I'm going to play a few minutes of, Hello Processing, is an hour of code event that the guy who invented processing does. He's incredibly enthusiastic, and he will show you some of the things people have made with processing.
Hi, how are you? My name is Dan. Welcome. If you're here, which hopefully you are, if you're watching this video, you're here to learn programming. Hopefully, you're here to learn programming for the very first time. This is going to be a tutorial. It's designed for you to take about an hour to complete. There's going to be lots of stuff happening in it. I'm going to talk, hopefully not too much. I'm going to draw pictures and diagrams over here on this whiteboard. Sometimes this video is going to get a lot smaller, and there's going to be text below me, and things drawn to the left of me over here. We're going to look at programming in the context of the visual arts. What does it mean to write software to do the things that you often do with your hands, with paper, with pencil, with paint? Could you use a computer to create drawings, to create animations, to create images? This is what we're going to look at. So before we get started with the actual nuts and bolts of learning to code, let's take a moment to look at a range of projects, things that have been made in recent years with computer programming for the visual arts. This is Strata number 3 by Quayola. Quayola is an artist working in London. This animation combines computer-generated images with video of a cathedral in Rome to create a fantastic new reality. In his own words, he is investigating improbable relationships between contemporary digital aesthetics and icons of classical art and architecture. This is Oasis by Yoon Sil Ho. She is a media artist working in Seoul. Oasis is an interactive installation. By moving around the sand, small pools are created where new software features are born and live. This is Replica by Alex Vessels and Jeff Howard. Alex and Jeff are interactive artists and designers working in New York. Replica is an interactive dance performance that uses live image processing to explore how the awareness of time and captured images affect self-perception. It was projected onto a 120-foot video wall in New York. This is Unnamed Sound Sculpture by Daniel Franca and Cedric Kiefer. Daniel and Cedric are media artists working in Berlin. This animation is a moving sculpture created from the recorded motion data of a live dancer. These animation and installation projects are just one way that visual artists are working with code. More traditional design areas such as map design, brand identity, and logo design and illustration are transformed through designers writing their own code. This is the Density Map by Fathom Information Design. Fathom is a design studio in Boston. This map uses circles of different sizes and colors to visualize population density in a unique way. Larger, darker circles show areas with fewer people, while smaller, brighter circles highlight crowded cities. By glancing at this map, we quickly get a sense of how some cities and countries are more densely populated than others. This is the logo for the MIT Media Lab, created by the Green Isle. The Green Isle is a studio based in Berlin. The identity system can be used in different ways in many contexts, including the lab's website, business cards, and in any other media. It forms a mutable identity that is synonymous with the Media Lab's approach to the ever-changing nature of technology. In addition to the kind of work we're looking at already, there's sculpture, fashion design, architecture, products, jewelry, pottery, much, much more. What does writing software have to do with these physical objects? Everything. It's an area of exciting and emerging possibility. New technologies make it possible to print objects. For example, it's now possible to design a ring in software and print it in plastic or metal. Let's look at three final examples before starting to learn how to code. This is the D-Dress software by Mary Huang. Mary is an entrepreneur and designer working in New York. D-Dress is a program written by Mary that allows a user to sketch a dress and then automates the pattern creation. It reimagines the classic little black dress by changing the relationships between manufacturing, the designer, and the wearer. The textile room was created by the architecture studio Patterns, founded by Georgina Olhek and Marcello Spina. Georgina and Marcello are architects working in Los Angeles. The textile room is an experimental media space where carbon fiber textiles are augmented with a video collage. This is Cell Cycle by Nervous System, a design studio founded by Jessica Rosenkrantz and Jesse Louis Rosenberg. Jessica and Jesse are entrepreneurs and designers living in Boston. CellCycle is a program that allows people to design their own jewelry and then 3D print it. All of these projects we've just looked at are created with a software environment called processing. Processing is a way to program invented by artists and designers to be used by artists and designers. Processing is for making visual media. It focuses on writing programs to draw, create animation, and to build interactive experiences like video games. Hopefully, you're going to have a good experience learning to program, and I'm already having fun just talking to you, even though I don't really know who you are yet, because you're not here. There's a camera there. Okay, I'll talk to you later. Bye-bye.
He is that excited for the entire hour. But it's great. It's infectious. Before long, you'll be grinning. So what Sonic Pi offers for the musical, for the auditory processing, more than it offers for the visual. And I'm going to give part of another demonstration that I'm going to give about using code with hardware is going to involve processing, so we'll be able to see a demonstration of how it's working in action. But before that, I wanted to look at a couple of other things. So code fights. This is kind of a different form of self-expression. But for those that are competitive by nature, who like the challenge of competing with other people, and like being able to earn rankings and so forth, there is Code Fights. What Code Fights is it's an interactive competition where you log in and you'll be given some sort of a puzzle. You indicate what language you want to work in, be it Python or some other language, and then you're given a task. It might be, here's some code, there's something missing, could you add what's missing? It could be, there's a bug in this code, fix it. And it could be, we need some code written that does this, this, and this. So you might have to write the code. And when you're doing that, you are racing against the clock against another person who has been given the same task, right? Like, so you and that person are working to complete that task, and the person who does it faster wins the match. So Code Fights has, it has rankings. This is just their public-facing site. They also do something. They also will have tournaments. So they will have a fixed event where they'll have a proper tournament where everybody signs up and competes with each other, and there are brackets. And
to that point, if we get enough teams, we are going to host a code fight tournament across libraries. It's up to you guys to see if you can recruit a few people per library, and all it takes is a couple of people who are interested, and then we will host that with through CLRC, and we will get prizes for both the participants and the libraries involved. So just food for thought, we can get the participation.
Kano, or Kano, I'm not really sure how it's supposed to be pronounced, is a Raspberry Pi kit, it's more expensive than a flat-out Raspberry Pi. It costs about $100 for a Kano unit, as opposed to $30 or $40 for a Raspberry Pi. But what you get in a Kano unit is a lot of the stuff you'd have to buy anyway if you bought a Raspberry Pi, because it comes with a mouse, it comes with a keyboard, it comes with the cable you need to plug the Raspberry Pi into your television or into a monitor. But it also comes with a fantastic custom operating system that is entirely designed to engage with kids and to teach them how to code. So the thing is packed with games, but they're not your traditional games. They're much more like the types of things we've been looking at today. So you can play Pong and you can play Minecraft, but you don't actually get to play those games, or at least you don't get to play them until you use Scratch to create them. So it's right back to that, like, having to type the basic code for Breakout, right? Like, to play Pong on a Kano, you have to create Pong. And that means you get to create it however you want, right? Like, and when we do programs with the Kano kids, I will often do a little quick challenge with the kids once they get, once they figure out how they can make different variations of a game. And I'll say, okay, now make a level in the game that you can beat and none of the rest of us can. Right. Like, so it has to be like, try to make it a level that's so hard that you can beat it. So it has to be beatable. You have to prove you can beat it, right? Like, but so hard that none of the rest of us can actually beat it. So, you know, like looking at, if you're interested in Raspberry Pis as a platform to teach coding, I highly recommend Gano. A Raspberry Pi by itself is a single board computer that runs a Linux operating system, so it's pretty high tech, pretty technical. You need somebody who knows what they're doing to work with a normal Raspberry Pi, whereas this is much more user-friendly. It comes with this great book that is for kids that shows, you can see them paging through it, how to assemble the computer, and then how to get started on the computer doing all the different activities.
So, Casey, if you had, say, if you bought several, like you said you had your program, and you had several of them, do you take them apart and, you know, clean them before our next program? Is that what you do?
Yeah, for what we have at OCPL right now, the Canos are actually part of what we call our Mobile Maker Labs.
Great.
So I spoke about this in the earlier session today, we have these kits that have all kinds of different STEM and maker-themed activities that can go to any library in the system through our ordinary delivery. So they can just book it on a special website, and then in the same van that delivers the Holtz has these red bins that has this stuff in it. The Kano is one of these kits. So it goes to the library, and it's generally a two and a half hour long program where the kids to open up the box, and they have to assemble the whole computer, and they have to start it up. And then they go through the introduction to the Kano. There's, you know, I personally would like to have a Kano and just have it on so the kids could go a little deeper into it, because what ends up happening is they generally have an hour on the actual computer. It takes an hour to build it, and then they have an hour on it. And there's lots more to do with it than you can do in an hour. But yes, in answer to your question, do we have to take it apart? Yes, we do, right? Like, because it's, you know, part of the experience that we want to give them is this sense. It's not really real. Like, you know, they say you're building a computer, but really the computer is a single solid piece of your construction. But you're putting a case around it, and you're plugging the keyboard and the peripherals into it. We want to give them the sense of interacting with the hardware, in the sense of, like, this is a computer that I built myself, right? Like,
So do you have to, I mean, if they create programs or things like that, I mean, do you have to clean those up, or they don't really have time to even get into that too much in your workshops?
We do have to clean them. It's pretty simple though, because it is based in Linux. So there's just a one line of code you type into this spot, and it resets the whole unit.
Okay.
Right, like it was never used before.
Okay.
And so you don't have to go and fiddle with that too much.
No.
Right?
Okay. Thank you.
No problem. Little bits. Little bits are an electronics STEM kit, and what the premise of little bits, I have some right here, is that you have all these different components that are color coded. So right here I have a blue, which is the power, and it's the only one that is blue. So I can plug a battery into this. And then there are green bits, like this green bit. And as far as the bits are concerned, they connect magnetically. So see, that just snapped together. The nice thing about this, when you're doing STEM programming around electronics, is that you do have to be worried about short-circuiting. You don't want somebody to wire a battery up to itself, because the battery could get very hot and it could rupture. Little bits are great because of their design. It makes this physically impossible. If I try to wire this the wrong way, the magnets repel each other. They won't let me make physical contact with the unit unless I put the circuit in the right orientation.
That's cool.
So that makes these really safe. So the green bits do something, right? So if I turn the power on, this particular green bit shows a light. There's all kinds of green bits. So this actually has like a bar graph. It shows a whole bunch of lights. They're all on right now, which kind of begs the question, well, why do you have all those lights if they're all on? Because there's another kind of bit that's pink, which is the do something bit. So this is a slider. And as I move the slider, I change the current through the circuit, and I can control the bar. So little bits are great for learning electronics. They're a great platform to explore robotics, to explore just simple, more simple and direct scientific type topics. So I did a whole series in Tully in the elementary school with little bits, and we just talked about light and sound. That's how we use the little bits. Right? So we use it as a way of illustrating some scientific discussion of light and sound, and how these things are energy and stuff like that. But you can you can vastly extend even the capacity of the little bits. So I just want to say little bits by themselves are pretty incredible, but where you can get really crazy and have lots of fun is with this particular little bit. This little bit is an Arduino microcontroller. So some of you may have heard of an Arduino before. A microcontroller is it's kind of a baby computer. It's not exactly a computer, but it is a chip that uses computer code to control electronic devices. And so, so whereas you can wire up some pretty sophisticated things with little bits by themselves, but you can see the relationships were pretty direct, right? Like if I wire in a dial to the thing, if I turn the dial up, the thing goes up. But with Arduino, we can program our own sequence of events. We can program our own logic into the Arduino and have the Arduino control the bits the way that we want to. An example of how this works is that so there were some kids in Manhattan when little bits were first being developed that created this really great construction. There are these little bits that are bend sensors, so when you bend them, they send a different signal. Like they're higher the more bent they are. And there are, of course, motors and servos that will move depending on what signal you give them. So this group of kids built this really fun sort of thing, which was basically a cardboard hand that came out of a box and a glove. And they could put the glove on and they could move their hand, and the cardboard hand would do whatever their hand was doing, right? That was done with just plain simple little bits, right? Like that was just saying, take the reading of my fingers and apply those directly to the servo controlling the fingers on the robot. But they didn't stop there, because once they did that, they got an Arduino involved. They put an Arduino in the robot hand and programmed it to play rock, paper, scissors with them, so that they could put on the glove and throw paper, rock, or scissors, and then the glove would randomly decide to throw paper, rock, or scissors with them, and it could tell which of them won, and it could project the score on a little display that was also a little bit that was on the outside of the box. So that's an example of the kind of like what happens when you get coded. And what I have here is an example. So I'm going to quickly put together here a little bit construction. And this is the example I said that I was going to use processing for. So this is something where I think we'll have to probably get up and come to this table and see what's going on and stretch our legs a little bit. And assuming, of course, it works. Remember the maker motto, failure is always an option. Okay, so we have those sliders connected to the Arduino, and we have the Arduino connected to the computer through using a USB cord, and we have processing running a visualization for us. So careful not to disconnect anything. What I have just made is an Etch-a-Sketch.
Oh, very cool. Oh, my word. Wow.
But the weird thing about this is what's so great about Little Bits is it's so easy to switch components. So,
without electrocuting yourself.
Without electrocuting yourself, or really without breaking the system.
I had a kid do that on an NXT Lego Mindstorm robot, too. He pulled an Etch a Sketch with that.
So my pressure sensor isn't really working very well, but I have switched, you can see, a dial. Oh, I know where my pressure sensor is. It's not actually connected. So I need some wire. But suffice to say, that's a demonstration of how you can, again, coding to express yourself. We're moving into the idea of, like, you can code physical objects, you can code robots, but also all kinds of other devices in order to do whatever you want, right? Like, you know, to take whatever input, whatever input you want, you can then have, you can then program it to do whatever you want in response.
Mm-hmm. Do those batteries ever wear out? I mean, they look like a normal battery, but it's buy replacements or it's just
Wires
or?
Yeah, we, no, I mean, that's just their brand new battery. I have in my makerspace, I have rechargeable 9 volts, so we don't go through as fast. It depends on what kind of load you put on, because you've got, like, there are, like, servo bits. There's a whole series of bits that allow you to make a synthesizer, like a musical synthesizer, that's actually produced in partnership with Korg, so it's basically the same as the old synthesizers from the 70s. And they can get noisy and also. While we're all gathered around this little computer, I thought I'd show another processing sketch. This is like maybe 5 lines of code. And depending on the height of my mouse as I pass over it, it changes the hue of the bar. So again, it's that ability to code to say, like, here we can make a visualization where we can use the input of our participant. Certainly for all kinds of, like, functional things, right? Like, you know, making an informational display or, you know, like, directing people to do something or something like that, providing a service for them, that's necessary. You need that interactive. But it's also a very exciting thing you can do for art and expression. And both are possible with processing, which is completely free, by the way. These are not. We'll hang around in the front here for the next demonstration. So if you don't mind standing or put this up. So the next one, and a personal sort of favorite of mine, is robotics. I love robotics. I love doing robotics programs for kids in libraries. Because I think that you cross so many different areas of interest with robotics. So I was actually had the pleasure to be a coach for a robotics competition team, like the first Lego Wing.
Was it first Lego Wing?
It was actually first Tech Challenge. It was the level just above first Lego Wing. And on that team, I saw the potential of robots as a STEM education program. So it was on that team, that I had a group of kids that before we got started were all of them just dumping on their geometry class, their geometry people, how useless this was, how boring she was, and on and so forth. And then 45 minutes later, we're trying to get a robot to do a right turn and had protractors on the floor and graph papers and graphing calculators, and we're just passionately engaged with geometry, right? Like, also, I think that there's so much going on with the robot, from the fact of you can use a robot to explore the physical design of the robot. So, how do we build it? How do we arrange it? And that all lends itself to a project-based, purpose-driven sort of thing. So the question is, what do you want your robot to do? And that really drives its design. Then there's a programming element of how do you program the robot in order to perform its task and so forth. And working with robots and kids, I found that there seems to be enough tasks that absolutely everybody, regardless of their interests, can get invested in a robotics program. So this is an MBOT. I call her Agnes. And it's an interesting product I recommend from a company called Make Block. A couple of things about them, though. If you go to their website, you will notice that it is poorly translated. They are a Chinese company, and they have not had a good English translator really go over their website. And they're not. But the reason why I favor this particular system over other robotic systems that are available, like Lego Mindstorms, actually also like some of the other ones I've shown, like Cubelets, and Moss Robotics and Dex Robotics, is that this system is very much non-abstracted. What we have here is an aluminum frame with the same kind of motors you would buy from the hardware store, with an Arduino microcontroller on the top. So this is near as how you would build this robot from scratch as if you had built it from scratch. So it gives that really direct experience. I also like it because you can program it with a cable. So many of these devices today work by pairing them wirelessly through Bluetooth using an iPad or something like that, which is great when it works. But the worst thing that has ever happened to me, and it's happened to me far too many times, is that I have 6 kids with 6 devices and 6 iPads, and none of them are connected, right? Like, and I'm just racing around trying to get the iPads to connect, and then some smart kid realizes that they can connect to other people's robots and mess with them, and that starts happening. And so I really like the MakeBox platform because I can, and I actually am right now, controlling this robot wirelessly, so it offers that feature. But that doesn't work for some reason, I have a backup. I can actually plug it into a computer with a USB cable and I can program it that way. So to give an example of a programmed behavior, I can make Agnes do. So I can remote control Agnes and show all the things you could program for her to do, like also the lights on. You can see I can make the lights change color. And you see here these are some distance sensors, so you could program Agnes to respond in some way if she saw something in front of her. So you could respond by like moving out of the way of obstacles, which is a good way to use it, or she could ram into obstacles. She also has, it's not very obvious, a color sensor pointed down. So right there, that should be a color sensor. If I tell her to track, this is program behavior, so taking readings from that color sensor in order to adjust its position as it moves across the circuit, or across the figure eight. So see how that, now I'm trying to mess with it.
So you prefer something like that over Mindstorms, can I ask why?
Oh, certainly. Yeah.
Because we're pretty invested in the Mindstorms, so they're not going away from our library for a while.
but yeah. I'm just curious.
No, there's a couple reasons, like, and by all means, like, I was in a position to start fresh, and so, you know, like, one of the reasons, if you want to, you can return to your seats. There's no more live demonstrations like that. And frankly, one of the reasons why I abstained from going with Mindstorms was because I'm not necessarily disinterested in using Mindstorms, but I am personally looking at the possibility of actually doing a first LEGO League team through the Central Library.
Oh, okay.
And I would like to tie that, you know, the purchase of equipment to that, you know, possibility.
Mm-hmm.
Another reason why I like the Make Blocks more than the Mindstorms is, as you can see on the package here, that should be familiar by now, that's Scratch.
Mm-hmm.
So you can program Make Blocks robots with Scratch,
okay.
Which I find much better and more direct analog to the
Mindstorms
to coding than the Mindstorms graphical interface.
I can see that.
So,
which I think is why we added the Arduinos this time, because
mm-hmm.
we're going to be using that
yep.
for like a more advanced group of kids that took it last year, and you know
mm-hmm.
we're in the program last year and want to step up this year, so they're
yeah.
going to learn how to program things.
Yeah, no, that's a really good idea too. So if you're interested. Another way you can explore this, I've showed how you could use Little Bits to program an Arduino. I've showed you
mm-hmm.
a robot that's based on Arduino. This is another kit that I recommend. It's the Spark Fun Adventures kit. It's an Arduino microcontroller with a breadboard and dozens of electrical components. But what's really great about this particular kit is it comes with a fantastic instruction book, full color instruction book. It walks you through 16 different experiments you do with the Arduino, all the way from the I've never done anything with electronics and I've never done anything with computer programming, let me figure out how to link a light, to doing pretty sophisticated stuff by the 16th lesson. And so I always am looking for things like this that have a curriculum in the box, right? Like knowing that I'm making kits that in some cases I want to send out to people I don't know, right? Like I don't know what their priorities might be, I don't know what their capacity might be. And so I really like the Spark Fun Adventures kit because it's got it all, right? Like it's got not just the hardware, but it's got the instruction too. So I'm getting a couple of these for the makerspace, and one of the things I'm planning to do is a couple of kids who say they want to do Arduino, so I'm going to hand them one of these and say, go. Yeah.
And I find even if I can't do it, if I hand it to the kids and say, you know, this is the basics,
yeah,
run with it. They'll show me how to do it, and that's fine. That's my whole purpose. My purpose isn't that I know, but
yeah,
that
it's
I
facilitation,
can give them
right?
Those,
like it's what we do as librarians
is we
facilitate. Well, I want to thank you. That concludes my presentation on coding and languages. Certainly, I'm available for discussion questions. Love to talk about other things. We can explore other things. If somebody wants to drive Agnes around, you can. Or play with the little bits, you can.
Will she do my desk?
You could modify her. Yep, you could. That wouldn't be so hard. Dusting wouldn't be so hard. I'm starting to think about it. You put a broom on the front of her and
let it pass the butter.
Yeah.
thank you to everybody here for coming, and thank you again to Casey for sharing all of this. As he said, this presentation and this morning's are available on his website. We're going to have the videos uploaded over the next week as well, if you want to look back at it. But as you're thinking about this, I know that one of the big things that comes up with this type of programming often is, and I overheard a little bit of your conversation, you know, it's okay, capacity.
Yeah.
And capacity is a challenge for all of our libraries. And it's something that we have to deal with. It's a reality that it's not just having the skills, it's not just having the familiarity, it's about having the staff hours to do it and figuring out how to do that. These are great ways to start the conversation with your staff and with your patrons, of just having these in a bookmark that's pushed to all of the machines in your library is a great way to start. Having one program a month where you're just getting the kids to come in and say, by the way, you can do all this stuff here, is a great way to at least start getting those things in motion. You're not going to be able to, you know, do everything that a superhuman like Casey can do right off the bat, but you can start and you can get there. The other thing is that as you find programming needs like this, if there is the, we, you know, just like there are, you know, it's the same question with, how do I get through these local history archives? How do I get through, you know, trying to do these separate or you know, different ancillary activities to library programming? We're working on it. Starting this summer, we have a circuit archivist that is available as a service. You know, it is a small fee service, but you are able to bring him in as part of your membership with MidYork and CLRC. We are considering doing the same sort of thing for this kind of programming. So if that is interesting to you, I don't want to, you know, this is not a, you can farm it out, because that's not the answer. It's not, farming it out is not the answer to capacity problems, but it can be a solution while we transition as a profession and while we transition our spaces. If that's something that's interesting, you know, get in touch and we can see what sorts of things we can help figure out. If that means, that can mean us coming in and doing more staff training. I know she's not here right now. We've got a few sites across MidYork that are doing some staff training with Mozilla's suites of tools over the next 6 months. We're gonna be hopefully expanding that and rolling that out so that all of your staffs can get experience and exposure with that kind of coding resource. But whether it's that kind of, you know, we bring it to your shop intensive, or whether it's somebody's bringing patron-facing programming to your shop, we can figure out a solution. And figuring it out together is a heck of a lot easier than figuring it out on our own, which is the whole point. So take those thoughts. I want you to continue to ask questions. And I think the biggest takeaway that I got from this presentation is that there are so many points of entry. And picking the one that's going to be right for you, the right for your staff, and the right for your space and community, it's all there, it's a spectrum. So think about that and think about what might work, and riddle Casey with questions all the time. So take that for what it's worth too.
You know, take your website seriously, you know, what did you say, why not ask me something or whatever?
Oh yeah, why not get in touch?
Why not get in touch, I love that. I'm gonna write that down.
Yeah, why not ask?
Well, and the fact of the matter is that, like, I don't purport to know everything, or even everything, or even most, or even a little about most of the things I shared with you, right? Like, I've in some cases dipped my toe into some of this stuff, right? Like, I'm no musician. I love playing Sonic Pi, but I didn't play you my stuff for a good reason. but that said, you know, I'm always looking and interested in looking at new things. I'm always exploring. So even if you're doing a coding program in your library, I'd just love to hear about it. I'd love to help you promote it, right? Like, I'd love to, you know, just to share, right? Like, so. And certainly, like, if you have any questions about this stuff, you know, coming in the next few months and over the next year, I'm going to be experimenting with a lot of the things I share. I'm going to be experimenting with doing a coder dojo, doing a hackathon, right? Like, where we have a 3-day period where people stay in the library all night and they work together to hack together some kind of a piece of code that could improve civic society, right? Like something that could really help. Sorry, did you?
Well, no, it doesn't really have anything to do with coding.
Yeah, that's okay.
Well, there's a. I participate in. I run a board game program at Jervis Library, and I participate in a now international event called International Day of Gaming, which is every November. But part of that, and, you know, and gaming of all sorts. So, you know, people do, you know, people, libraries participate in, you know, that event, sponsoring video game programs, board gaming programs, any kind of gaming is fair game. But one of the things that they've introduced in the last, I think this is the third or fourth year that they've done it, is called the International, what's it called? It's called the Minecraft Hunger Games.
Mm-hmm.
So the way that works is a library or a group of libraries sponsors a tournament where their kids compete against each other and come up with a boy winner and a girl winner. And those kids are the tributes, if you've read The Hunger Games, the tributes to the international event of The Hunger Games. And on International Games Day, they compete against all the tributes from all the other libraries. So you're from section, they'll give you a number. You know, they'll give you a number. You're from sector, you know, in The Hunger Games, it was sectors 1 through 12, right? So you could be from sector 235 or something like that, depending on how many libraries are participating. And on that day, they'll compete against each other, and they'll come up with a winner. And I think last year, a 12-year-old girl from Massachusetts won. You know, so that's not a coding thing, but you were talking about points of entry.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that a lot of kids do at our library is play Minecraft.
Yeah.
So, you know, so I'm thinking of, you know, if there were to be a coding thing, perhaps Minecraft coding would be something that, you know, we could get started with and do the international hunger, the Minecraft Hunger Games thing.
Yeah, we have libraries. Monday Library did 100 Hunger Games this year. Kids were super excited.
Yeah.
I helped them set the servers up.
It's, yeah.
It's a really great thing. Speaking of Minecraft and as an entry to coding, Minecraft is a game that has a bunch of mods. These are plugins you can actually use to change something about it. And there's a really great mod called ComputerCraft that adds computers to the Minecraft world, which is, I think, is neat, but I'm a nerd. But the cooler thing that it adds are those little unassuming gray boxes with the little pickaxe. Those are called turtles. And what those are basically robots that you can program in Minecraft to do everything that a player can do Minecraft. So I do programs where I say, I'm going to teach you how to code these turtles so that you can automate something about Minecraft that you don't like to do on your own. So you can, you know, Minecraft is a game where you build things, but you also mine things. So you have to mine the raw materials in order to build things. So if you're, you know, if you're somebody who likes to build but doesn't really like having to go out and dig, you know, and mine all the materials, you could program your turtle to mine a quarry for you and automatically gather all the raw materials you need. It's the other way around. You really like exploring, but you don't really want to actually lay the bricks of your wall. Well, program a turtle to lay the bricks of the wall automatically.
Any other questions, ideas, thoughts? All right. Well, thanks again, Casey, and thanks everybody here for coming out today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
And you will see a survey in the next 48 hours. Please fill it out. And if there are other things that you want to learn about or you want to learn more about, let us know so we can help. What's that?
Good thoughts
at
times like this,
and
I go back and I'm inundated with the rest of the world.
Yeah. And don't forget to nominate your library and your staff for the awards. It's deadline's next week. Thanks for coming.
Nice to see you, Jen. I hear about you all the time.
Everything's going well over there?
It is. It is.
Yeah, I heard you were a little bit of a rabble-rouser. I did hear that before.
What? Not me.
The community. I forget what it was now. Something about using them. Oh, I know what it was. They need to change their resources.
Yeah. It's like, no, we're not doing that anymore.
And I coordinated it wrong, so no, I was excited.
We will.
Thank you.
No doubt about it.
The ones that I actually got with the makerspace company, Absolutely.
I mean, why not?
Yeah.
Yeah.